Welcome, everyone, to the KEI Economic Institute of America. My name is Kyle Ferrier. I'm the Director of Academic Affairs and Research at KEI. Today's program is part of our academic paper series, in which KEI commissions up to 10 papers each year on topics of contemporary interest to Korea and the United States. Papers are compiled in our On Korea Journal, and the paper for today is located just outside. If you haven't picked it up yet, I would please encourage you to do so. It will also be available online, as well as the video for this program will be available online after the program ends. When we talk about One Belt, One Road, Korea is often overlooked, and today's program is intended to sort of bridge that gap, especially as Korea has its own regional initiatives to pursue in Central Asia and beyond. So today's program to talk about this features Dr. Balbina Hwang. She is a visiting professor at Georgetown University, where she teaches courses on Asian politics and political economy. From 2007 to 2009, Balbina Hwang served as the senior special advisor to Ambassador Christopher Hill at the State Department. Prior to her time at State, she taught North. She was a senior policy analyst for Northeast Asia in the Asian Studies Center for the Heritage Foundation and lecturer at Georgetown University. She holds an MBA from Darden Business School at the University of Virginia, a Master's of International Affairs from Columbia University, and a PhD in Government from Georgetown University. Dr. Hwang will give a short presentation, and then afterwards we'll open up the floor to Q&A. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Hwang.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to see you here today. I think I do see one or two of my students. I'm sure they're here for the free lunch. I don't know. But take notes. There will be a quiz. I'm just kidding. There will not be a quiz on this. I promise. But it's nice that you're interested and that you showed up. I need to first of all thank KEI, obviously more than just the generous lunch, but actually for sponsoring this project and for being so encouraging, especially Kyle, who is infinitely patient. I can't remember when I first approached you, but it was a long time ago, and this project has seen many, many iterations. And he was extremely helpful in actually getting me a little bit more focused and down to where we are today in this paper that was published. Unfortunately, what you have in front of you is probably, I don't know, I have about 60 other pages more of content, very interesting, but probably too detailed information. So, and I'm happy to go on and on about the subject, probably a little too much. So happy to do that with anybody outside of this lecture. But in any case, today, I'm going to try to stay focused. Obviously, KEI Economic Institute, I want to stay focused on Korea. You'll have to follow me. You'll have to be patient and bear with me as we go down the winding road. Sorry, pun intended. We'll eventually get to Korea, but first we have to make our way through China and actually the rest of Eurasia to get there. Now, let me also actually thank one other source. Actually, my interest in this topic, which is One Belt, One Road, is something that I had never, frankly, paid very much attention to. Now it's actually sort of become an obsession for the last, actually well over 12 months. But my interest in this topic was sparked by a very intriguing observation made to me by a senior British diplomat in the autumn of 2015. I don't know if we have any representatives from Britain over here, but and the comment was made to me during a conference on the Asia Pacific, which was hosted in Canada, another one of our Commonwealth friends. We ought to pay attention because they actually sometimes have a better view about U.S. and Asia Pacific relations than we tend to, being in our own fishbowl. But in any case, he admonished me that meaning Americans, we were not paying nearly enough attention to China's One Belt, One Road. A subject that was monopolizing his time then as head of Asian affairs at the Foreign Ministry. And in fact, what I discovered, and so that sort of intrigued me, and I thought, he's right, I don't really know what One Belt, One Road is. I think I heard of it. I vaguely know what it is. So I came back home and I started to read up on it. And it was true. Number one, it's utterly fascinating. I think I could dedicate the rest of my career to this topic. But number two, it is absolutely the case that the world is, the United States certainly, is not taking very serious note of China's ambitious project. And evidence that the United States is well behind everybody else is, in fact, what South Korea has been doing with its Eurasia initiative, which I will ultimately get to. So now, first a disclaimer, I am by no means a Central Asia or Eurasia expert, and I see that we have some real Central Asia experts in the audience, so I certainly defer to them. I do not even consider myself a China expert. I think there probably are some China experts in the audience as well. I have been studying China now for a number of years, but by no means do I consider myself a China expert. And so this project is a fruit of my role as a student, a very studious one, but nevertheless a student that is still learning on this immense subject of One Belt, One Road. Okay. Now, a second disclaimer, this paper, and I feel a little bad, and I say Kyle is very patient because I feel as if I may have misled him a little when I first sent him a proposal, an abstract of and my outline of this topic. It was not what the final product ended up being. And I don't think I could have imagined how it would turn up. I did start off very faithfully with every intention to stick to that original proposal. But I think anybody who starts to delve into this topic begins to realize that the parameters can take you in very, very interesting and unexpected directions. So what I began to realize, and even towards the end, is that the issues at stake in One Belt, One Road are actually far greater, far deeper, and frankly, far more profound, not just for Korea, but for the United States and the world. And in many ways, this project was sort of like playing with Matryoshka dolls, the Russian nesting dolls. Only every time I opened up one doll, the one inside was actually larger. And so it was sort of a weird experience where I would open it up and it would, the subject would be even bigger and bigger and bigger. And every doll that I kept opening up actually managed to raise even greater issues. So that was sort of a daunting experience for me. Now, let me actually begin this presentation by bringing to your observation two intriguing events. Now, my students know that I insist that they read newspapers every day very carefully, and they also know that I've told them that the most interesting articles are usually the smallest ones buried in the very back of the papers. So, let me see. So the first one was dated back in November. Now, this goes all the way back to 2014, if you can remember that far. Okay, and I'll go over what this map means in a moment. But on November 18th in 2014, an 82-container freight train departed Yiwu on the eastern coast of China, and 21 days later arrived, and you can see that path there in the dark yellow, in the red. The upper yellow is the Trans-Siberian Railway. It took 21 days and arrived in Madrid, Spain, which is not quite the coast, but certainly the westernmost reaches of the European continent. Now, nobody in the United States really paid any attention to this. By the time it made its return trip home to Yiwu, the train had traversed 16,651 miles round trip. And although the cargo was comprised of negligible trinkets and holiday toys, it was the first shipment of perhaps hundreds of billions of dollars worth of future trade between the two continents. And this was actually an incredibly historic trip because it was the first complete connection along the new Eurasian land bridge, one of the six primary land corridors of One Belt, One Road. I'll get to each of those in just a few minutes. But this makes it the single longest continuous train link in the world. And the Trans-Siberian Railway, of course, is the famous one that has been the longest. But this one certainly surpasses the Trans-Siberian Railroad. Now, the second intriguing news event just happened a few days ago. On November 13th, 2016, and again, I could not find this reported anywhere in any of the major U.S. papers. On November 13th, fanfare marked the departure of the first ships sailing out of Gwadar Port, in Pakistan, for international destinations. Now, what is significant about this? If you follow the, I don't know, does this actually have a little? Oh, yes, it does. The the trucks, and it was a convoy of 125 cargo trucks, loaded up in western China, which is Xinjiang province, and traveled the entire way by road the first time, all the way through Pakistan, and then were loaded on ships bound for international destinations. Now, this is important. This is actually highly significant because this marks the launching of the so-called China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, the CPEC. And this land journey marks the realization of the second of the land corridors of the Belt Road. And more important, what it does is it links to the port. You'll notice that the train to Madrid ended in a non-coastal city. Gwadar Port is crucial because now it links the maritime, the one belt, and the one road part, and it essentially brings the two together. So if you want to put a date on when the two are actually linked, it's probably November 13th, just a few days ago. Okay, so these are just about two tangible realizations of the incredibly ambitious Chinese dream, some call it a fantasy, of One Belt, One Road. It is, in fact, the single most ambitious foreign economic strategy ever announced in modern times by any country. And it's hard to imagine that any other country will come up with anything this big to match this scale, even for the next several hundred years, unless we're talking about venturing, you know, out into the ultimate ultimate frontier in Star Trek? Basically off of the Earth. So and when we're talking about earthly projects, this is probably the single most ambitious. If fully realized, and of course it's a big, giant if, One Belt, One Road will fundamentally alter the economic, political, and social relationships between the Eastern world and the Western one. There is no doubt about that. There is no doubt that the relationships are being changed and they will change. The question really is, will it change as much as it is envisioned by the Chinese leadership? That is really the question that nobody knows. Now, the official announcement by Xi Jinping was in September 2013. And what is most notable, though, about the timing is that just 1 month later, in October, South Korea's president, Park Geun-hye, articulated her own vision for an east-west connection. This announced a new era of so-called Eurasia, dubbed the Eurasia Initiative, or EAI, and Park Geun-hye echoed Chinese visions of building the Silk Road Express, which she called for a physical linkage of the Western European continent with the farthest eastern end of the Asian continent. Of course, Koreans are not ones to be outdone by anybody, not even the Chinese. So leave it to the Koreans to say that they're going to extend these connections a little bit further. So the paper that you have in front of you basically examines these two grandiose visions. It analyzes both the rationale, the contours, assesses the possibilities of success of both One Belt, One Road and EAI, and then the implications of both of these projects. But since my specialty is Korea and not China, I offer in the paper, and I will do so here in the presentation as well, some conclusions about how EAI reflects South Korea's national and regional aspirations, and then discuss a bit about the security implications for both countries and the region. And this is where this paper project took a very surprising turn, because I actually did not think that North Korea would come up at all, or if it did, in passing. And in a way, that's why I wanted to do this project, because I wanted to not do something on North Korea for once. Again, shockingly, what I ended up realizing is EAI, terribly difficult acronym, comes ultimately actually back to North Korea. And North Korea ends up being the pivot. It becomes the key to the entire project. So with that little intriguing note, stay tuned, and I will eventually get there at the end of my presentation. First, though, I want to set the stage and provide a contextual background for the regional dynamics. And this is extremely important. Without this kind of understanding, you really will not understand the conclusions that I end up reaching. So for today, I'm going to provide a very brief overview of One Belt, One Road, what it is, its motives and goals, how it fulfills Chinese economic and political ambitions. And then second, I will do essentially the same with South Korea. And then I will finally conclude with arguing about the implications or presenting the implications of the two visions. Okay, and then I look forward to your questions and a lively discussion. So let me see now. Oops, wrong way. It's a little confusing. Okay, so this is obviously a map of Eurasia. Now, looking at this map, there is no doubt that something is afoot in the Central Asian region. Okay, there is and there has been an invigoration of activity and energy swirling around the geographical nexus that forms the physical connection between the European and Asian continents. Of course, one can argue that this has always been the case, and it's just sort of people are paying attention to it now, and they weren't before. And that argument I certainly can't agree with. But we should keep in mind that China's One Belt, One Road is only one of a flurry of great powers and their strategies, dreams, and visions for the region that in one way or another is pushing for renaissance of the ancient 2,000-year-old Silk Road. Okay, and among these, among the competing, I don't know if any are at the same level as China's One Belt, One Road, but the competing visions offered by regional neighbors, great powers, has been Russia with its Eastern Dream, India with its Axe East policy, Japan, which has a free and open Indo-Pacific strategy, and arguably even the U.S. with its pivot to Asia, joins this great game. And now, interestingly, South Korea, in nobody's mind, certainly a great power, actually has joined and is jockeying for traction in this region. So that's, to me, also a very intriguing development, that in and of itself. And I'll come back more to about Korea's position in the region. Now, it's difficult to say or argue that China's One Belt, One Road is the pivot or the cause of increased interest and activity by the others. I know some can argue that. I personally cannot put a causal relationship on this. Is it that China has caused all the other great powers to start paying attention and become more active? I don't know. Or is it merely that, as with all things that China does, it's the sheer enormity and scale and ambition of One Belt, One Road that just provides a gravitational pull around which everyone else orbits? Now, despite the foregone conclusion or acceptance about a globalized world, there is still a clear substantive and physical barrier dividing the West and East. Okay. And one notable observation is that, as in previous eras, intra-regional integration efforts in the Asia-Pacific are largely being driven by multiplicity of great power interests. Okay, again, I'm turning on the wrong page. Oops. Uh-oh. What did I just do? Okay, there we go. Am I in the wrong... Probably. Okay. Well, anyway, we'll just keep it on that. Okay. Now, let's see. All right. So I think I'm already getting a signal that I'm running it. So let me just fast forward then, moving ahead to some of these things. Okay. Let me just quickly get through kind of the logistics of One Belt, One Road. It's actually a little confusing because there's one part, which is the Silk Road Economic Belt. Okay. I keep doing that. Sorry. Let me just... Okay, these are the six corridors. Okay, here we go. Silk Road Economic Belt. Now, this was first announced in Kazakhstan in March 2013 by Xi Jinping. The Silk Belt is the overland network of transportation corridors. Okay, so it's everything linking land territories that is to be developed under Chinese direction. Okay, it includes roads, rail lines, pipelines, telecommunication networks. And what's important here is that, and I think my previous map should show this. That was the point of this. I know it's in German. Ignore the German. Just look at the graphics. It's from a very nifty German think tank that does these very cool graphics that show you. This is actually just meant to show you the concentration of populations. China has over 30 megacities, defined as 10 million or more, which are all essentially on the coastal areas. Okay, but so the reality is that you have all of this vastly, I'm obviously not very proficient with technology, vastly undeveloped Western corridors. And so, in fact, China's attempt to link with these regions outside in its northern and western territories are really an extension of a decades-long project within China itself to develop infrastructure networks. So it's actually a natural extension just to extend them outside of its own borders. Okay, but I will discuss in a minute, though, why that leap outside its borders is actually very significant. Okay, now, by the way, so the original Silk Road, okay, so let me just see. Okay, so these are the so-called economic belts, and this map really just shows you the rail links, but there's obviously another network of roads, pipelines, and so on. Okay, now, so these linkages, they look north towards energy-rich Mongolia and Siberia, and not just west to Central Asia, the Caucasus, Middle East, and Central Europe, but then also south, towards the Asian subcontinent, Southeast Asia, and even southwest towards Africa. Okay, and the goal is to create one cohesive economic area. Okay, through all of these development of these land infrastructures. Okay, and by 2015, almost $900 billion had been pledged in more than 900 projects involving some 60 countries as part of this One Belt project. Okay, now, again, I'm going to go very quickly through this because this information certainly will be in the paper. The One Belt, and again, so it's important to keep in mind that the announcement was pronounced in 2013. But in fact, this is the announcement sort of came after decades of many of these projects already being in place. So the significance of One Belt, One Road is actually that Xi Jinping has essentially provided and articulated a vision, a strategy for something that China's actually been doing for a long time. But it's actually useful because for the first time articulated that the One Belt portion, the land portion, is divided into six land corridors. Okay, and you see them there. It's certainly listed in the paper. I don't have time to list them all. And so that comprises the belt portion. Now, the road portion, the one road, is actually confusing because it doesn't refer to the land corridors. It actually refers to the maritime Silk Road. So the One Belt and then the One Road, the 21st century maritime Silk Road, is actually no less ambitious than the One Belt portion. Okay, and let me see. Go. Okay, so now this map shows you where the two are linked. So you'll see that the land portions here in the darker brown and then links up, crucially, with all the maritime. And you'll see that that's why strategically all of these crucial ports in very strategic ports of water have been targeted and are being developed to provide these linkages. Okay, so the Maritime Silk Road seeks to build infrastructure throughout the Indo-Pacific, the Middle East, and actually links the African coastal regions, okay, which ultimately envisions having the Pacific and Indian Oceans in the east linked with the Mediterranean and Red Seas in the west via the Suez Canal. And, of course, the Indian Oceans are linked through connections in Tanzania, Mozambique, and Kenya. China recently announced a $3.8 billion railroad connecting Nairobi with ports, right, in Mombasa. Okay, so again, the marrying of the two is what's crucial. You will really have an incomplete project if you start building all these roads and they just sort of end up nowhere. Because the idea is not so much to bring commerce and goods necessarily into Pakistan, but actually through Pakistan as a launching point for the rest of the world. And obviously, there are some other security strategic reasons for that port in Pakistan, which I hope I'll have time to get to. Okay, so very quickly, overall, One Belt, One Road is envisioned to span more than 65 countries. This is sort of an overview of the entire project. It involves 40% of global GDP. But most importantly, strategically, it has an the potential, and I underline the word potential, to make China the driving economic and diplomatic force for developing the entire Eurasia. And that's actually really the most important thing. I don't think anybody really doubts or questions that China's a great power. But China will, for the first time since its ancient empire, is going to be the driving force for the entire region and actually potentially even into the West. Okay. So the key question is this going to live up to expectations? Can it even be implemented? Now, the reality is, and I think there may be many of you in the audience that are skeptics, there are, and with good reason, a lot of skepticism. Okay, the sheer expansiveness of the project makes it amorphous and unwieldy. There is actually very little transparency. So nobody is very clear on exactly what it includes. So far, based on different government announcements or pronouncements or who you talk to, One Belt, One Road has been a convenient umbrella that includes everything from installing signs and info kiosks in Armenia to the $46 billion investment pledged in Pakistan to build the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. So if it includes all of these things, then the question is, what doesn't it include? And that's a good question. Okay. So ultimately, and again, there's so much literature out there about the economic impact of One Belt, One Road. No one can deny that that is probably the most significant tangible effect of One Belt, One Road. But I am more interested, since I'm not an economist, I'm actually more interested in the political aspects and the political implications of One Belt, One Road. And this is sort of my main point about One Belt, One Road, that actually I believe if we look back, I don't know if we'll be alive, I don't know if I'll be alive in 50 years, I'll just say that. But if we were to look back in 50 years or so, I believe that this this announcement, 2013, obviously symbolizes, it marks a profound watershed moment in Chinese modern foreign policy, because Xi Jinping is marking a significant, and some say even dramatic or revolutionary, shift in, maybe even permanent, shift away from China's long-standing foreign policy axiom. And it has been in place for China's modern history, but absolutely articulated very strongly by Deng Xiaoping, which deemed that China's national interests are in keeping a low international profile in order to focus on economic modernization stability. Now, One Road, One Belt puts all of that aside. It breaks that taboo. And it actually says in order to ensure continued economic modernization and stability, we're actually not going to stay quietly within our borders. We're actually going to venture out. And it marks a brand new era that casts aside this taboo. And actually, for the first time, China is actively intervening in foreign affairs, in the foreign spheres. These include building overseas military and naval bases, developing clear spheres of influence, creating buffer zones, and possibly even forging alliances. Informal ones now, we'll see if they become formal in the future. So I think that's really ultimately the most significant part of One Belt, One Road. So economically, even if none of this really ends up being manifested, I think actually this in itself is really the significant shift. Okay, now I think I'm running out of time, so let me just very quickly, there's obviously the most important section of this is understanding what China's motives and goals are. Again, if you please read the paper, I go into more detail there. Other than the obvious economic goals, and I think they're very clear, they fulfill short-term economic needs of China. It absolutely does address a lot of the short-term immediate economic issues that China is facing domestically. It also addresses sort of medium-term problems and challenges in the Chinese economy. But most importantly, it also, I believe the vision, seeks to address long-term economic challenges. The overall point, though, is meeting economic challenges for China is all about promoting national stability and strength. Now, that may sound a little odd to some of you who think, well, obviously any government's leadership should be concerned about that. But it's tangibly different, I think, in the way that China views this as the single priority of the leadership, and certainly the Communist Party leadership. So my argument is that this vast integration of projects, while they certainly fulfill economic goals, both short-term and long-term, ultimately serve the country's political objectives, which are to promote national stability and strength, but also expand the boundaries of what has been traditionally considered close-in region. Okay, and so, you know, again, you've got short-term economic objectives, boosting, creating greater demand, allowing new markets for the state-owned enterprises, which are clearly have reached overcapacity and so on. Okay, now, let me see. Okay, let me see if this map. Actually, okay, what one other, well, the, these two graphics just go to show you that, again, you know, Xi Jinping didn't just suddenly turn on the spigot in 2013. This has been built on at least a decade, if not more, of Chinese investments all around the developing world. But what these graphics do show you is that there is in fact, has been a tangible shift. China has pulled away from, and you'll see here this actually, this graphic shows it quite distinctly, that in fact, through the first decade of the 21st century, China had invested quite a lot in Latin America and Africa. But in fact, now you'll see that the proportion spent on Asia, and this includes Central Asia and so on, is significantly different, and Southeast Asia, South Asia, okay? Now, aside from the economic, and this is related, is one of the key issues for China is energy security. We certainly know this, and it's clearly tied to security issues. And again, very quickly, this graphic, if I can figure out, what's the old saying they say in Hollywood, never act with children and animals, and technology should be added to this list because it's very unreliable. At least it is for Luddites like me who are very unfamiliar with. Okay, I cannot. Here we go. All right, I just want to point this out. Now, currently, 85% of China's energy imports are through maritime routes. Okay, think about this. 85% are through maritime routes. But in fact, the majority of them are through these crucial chokeholds, which are actually quite vulnerable, or at least from the Chinese perspective. So you can begin to see why building all of these infrastructure, and if I can find the original map, going back, you'll see that a lot of expanding into these crucial ports all throughout South Asia, Southeast Asia, and even Africa and the Middle East is all about providing other alternative methods, not just for commercial trade, but actually for energy supplies. Okay. Now, one other thing to keep in mind, given that energy security is viewed very much not just as an economic issue for China, but a security issue, is that from China's perspective, and again, you have to look at it from sitting, you know, in Beijing here, not only is China vulnerable to having sort of being surrounded, by the way, I should point out, and I don't know if I can find the original map, China actually has the distinction of having the most land borders of any other country in the world. It has 14 land borders. So in many ways, China is geographically surrounded. Now, all across its borders, and its maritime borders where it's not physically surrounded, and the one neighbor, which China is probably most, I don't know if obsessed is the right word, but constantly thinking about the United States, which is obviously geographically very distant. In fact, from China's perspective, is essentially encircling China through its system of alliances and certainly, you know, the U.S. presence still in Afghanistan and so on. Okay, so I think this is actually a very important sort of strategic concern for China. Now, so what I argue, this is just a little graphic that shows that on top of that, if you were to add on, not only to the encirclement concerns China has, the announcement of the Asia pivot in 2012, which, you know, the United States actually was very specific about giving numbers and troop deployments. Again, from China's perspective, if you map on this announcement, which is not really an expansion, but certainly symbolize that. On top of this, you begin to see China's, paranoia, for lack of a better word, okay, in terms of its encirclement concerns. Okay. Now, Given all of these considerations, though, I think something else is driving China's rapid interest and expansion outside of its traditional borders. And I do not think it's an accident that it starts off most vigorously with its western borders. The one thing that China, and as I stated, this is my assumption, is China's leadership's number one priority of economic stability, national and domestic stability, which obviously includes economic, political, and social. Okay, and the three are clearly intertwined. One Belt, One Road can be considered a prophylactic strategy to promote long-term stability in neighboring countries. And the tool is through economic investment. But through economic investment, it creates not only just an interdependence, but China's ability to guide, direct, maybe even enforce its own type of development, which encourages strong political control over social movements, certainly religious or ethnic strife. And the idea is that the Communist Party, and especially Xi Jinping, are essentially obsessed with maintaining and ensuring stability internally, but also in neighboring countries. And I believe increasingly instability in neighboring countries is viewed as a direct threat to China's internal security. Now, it's important to remember that China has well over 1.4 billion people. The government officially recognizes 56 ethnic minorities, about 105 million people. The largest single minority is the Muslim Uyghurs. And we all know that they have been at fomenting essentially autonomous or independence movements. And unfortunately, it's using quite a lot of violence. So this is becoming a very serious issue. But remember for China, and that's obviously in the Western province, but remember that for China, we're going a little bit too ahead. Well, this is not the right map, but anyway. For China, it's not just the ethnic, the Uyghurs that are a problem. China has a problem with all other ethnic, autonomous, or pro-independence-minded ethnic minorities. And by the way, let me point out, especially here in the Jilin province, which, again, borders North Korea, 2 million ethnic Koreans. Who populate this region, and the issue for China is once one ethnic group, once an autonomous group decides through pro-independence agitation to leave the fold, then you have a major domino effect and a very, very serious problem. This is why China so brutally cracks down on any form of even the smallest whiff or symbol of pro-independence. Tibet, certainly Taiwan, and look at the recent elections this year in Hong Kong and Taiwan. I think this is why the Chinese reaction has been so severe and immediately clamped down on it, because to allow any sort of pro-independence movement anywhere in any of the ethnic groups within China essentially will set off and spark not only confidence, but perhaps interest among all the other groups, which may or may not be related, but it sets off a spark. And once one group goes, you're talking about the entire state system. I mean, it's the entire legitimacy and identity of the central state communist system. So the entire state essentially collapses. Which is why I think for China, the pro-democracy movements are actually secondary to pro-independence movements. Now, for those of us in the West, for us, it's not really much of a distinction. But for China, I think it is an important difference. Pro-democracy movements, you know, among students in Beijing or where else, they're less threatening than the pro-independence ones. But again, I think the leadership is very mindful that any pro-democracy movements will incite or spark interest, give ideas into autonomous movements. Which is why China, so much a part of the economic investments in the in Central Europe, is very much about supporting pretty authoritarian governments that are whose number one national security concerns are squelching ethnic movements or religious insurgencies, right, in these countries. And I think that's why China is so eager to help and assist in trying to stabilize. Because again, from China's point, it's not just to help Kazakhstan and Turkmenistan and Tajikistan with these internal problems, which, by the way, China never used to do, right? It was their ultimate policy of non-interference. But it is seen as a direct contribution to China's own national stability. It's something that I, for lack of a better term, have called extraterritorial stability, which is what I believe is driving China and driving the logic of One Belt, One Road, the political logic, I should say. So, and then now I don't have time to go into how China's able to fuse its economic and political power. Obviously, economic tools are crucial. The creation of the Asian infrastructure, the AIIB Bank, is absolutely critical. You also have to consider the Shanghai Cooperation Agreement and how that's expanding. That those two need to be married. It's interesting. I don't have time to discuss it here. Happy to do it elsewhere. I think it's time, though, that I turn to Korea, because if you're wondering when I was eventually going to get there, I will get there. Let's just start off by looking at this map. Okay, so little geography lesson, right? Just to keep in mind, I mean, we're all familiar with Northeast Asia, but just keep this in mind. Now, one Russian scholar recently noted that there has been a surprising source of what he calls an arrow aimed at strategic expansion into the Eurasian mainland. And he says it came from a very unexpected direction and the remotest actor of all, South Korea. And he deems the sheer scale of the idea as breathtaking. Now, I thought that was interesting given, you know, what can be more breathtaking than One Belt, One Road. But in fact, despite the relatively minuscule size of South Korea's Eurasia initiative, Park Geun-hye's Eurasia initiative, in fact, it is, it truly is breathtaking and astonishing. Now, President Park articulated her economic vision for the region, the Eurasia Initiative, in October 2013, as I stated. And it's, again, at the time, it did not seem particularly revolutionary or anything particularly new. South Korea has always had a strategic interest in engaging broader regions beyond Northeast Asia. And this was well developed by her predecessor, Iman Bak, under his New Asia Initiative, launched in 2009. Here, I'll make a small plug for KEI's other publications. Already several years ago, but I contributed two papers to KEI's Compass paper series. I believe they're still on their website. One focusing on Central Asia, South Korea's policies towards Central Asia, and one on Southeast Asia. They're quite extensive in providing a look at those relationships. So I encourage you to go there if you're interested in this. Now, in addition, what Park Geun-hye did was, again, not new, but she took part of the Eurasia Initiative, its expansion and its implementation, was marrying that with South Korea's embrace of free trade agreements. And in fact, the ROK-PRC, the South Korea-China Free Trade Agreement, finally signed in June 2015, after 3 years of negotiations, sort of put the final stamp on that connection. So at the time, there was this view that EAI would actually marry very well, it could be mapped together, essentially work very well together with One Belt, One Road, and that actually both countries could benefit together from these two, which were not really seen as anything particularly contradictory or, I mean, obviously there's some competitive dynamics embedded, but they don't necessarily, it's not fated to be competitive. Now, the linkage with FTAs is crucial. First of all, South Korea is one of the countries in the world that has been most aggressive about pursuing FTAs. And Kyle, you may actually know the answer, but I believe South Korea is on par to have the single largest number of free trade agreements, not just formal FTAs, but other types of agreements, practically more than I think any other country, which is quite astonishing for a country South Korea's size. But the idea is to link South Korea's numerous trading agreements to other areas within and outside Eurasia. And the two most important ones are RCEP, the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, and TPP. Now, you know, when I was writing this paper and submitted the draft a few weeks ago, TPP is looking less and less likely as events unfold. So whether or not TPP eventually comes to fruition. But interestingly, it's actually TPP that spurred the acceleration of RCEP, because the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership was seen as essentially the alternative to TPP, because it included the countries, the main countries, that were not part of TPP, namely China. So assuming, well, we shouldn't assume anything about the TPP anymore, but if the TPP ever comes to fruition and you have RCEP, which actually is beginning to seem more likely, you actually would have an overlapping of an incredibly broad commercial region. Okay. Now, if you thought China's One Belt, One Road was grandiose in its goals, you should consider South Korea's goals with its EAI. When fully integrated, the East Asia Eurasia Initiative will create, quote, a gigantic market accounting for more than 90% of the world economy, with the Korean Peninsula as the gateway to Eurasia, linking it across the Pacific Ocean all the way to the Americas. Now, there's one interesting thing about One Belt, One Road. It actually, if you notice on this map, and if we were to do... we were to do a world map and not just sort of a half of the world map, you actually will note that even though it's very much about expanding west, somewhat north, and south, but it's completely blind on its eastern flank. It basically completely, I mean, it goes into sort of, you know, very northeastern Asia up here. But basically, it completely ignores Japan, the Korean Peninsula, Japan, and then, you know, the Pacific trade that way. South Korea does not, obviously. So this, in some ways, is even more ambitious, if you thought that was possible, than One Belt, One Road. So EAI envisions a combined region encompassing 55 million square miles, or 40% of the world's land area, 78 countries, that's what, I don't know, 10 more, 15 more than China's One Belt, One Road, accounting for 70% of the global population. Excuse me. And most importantly, it takes One Belt, One Road, and it says, oh, we can do you, China, one better. We're going to go even further east. I mean, that rail link from Madrid all the way to the eastern part of China, which is supposed to be the most east, right? In fact, it would take it even further east, and the farthest tip south, which technically would be the southern half of the Korean Peninsula. Now, however... if you're thinking what I'm thinking, there's one major hurdle to East Asia Initiative. And if you look at the map, you can tell what that is. It's a physical barrier. And that barrier is, of course, North Korea. Here's the problem. North Korea is the physical and geographic barrier that blocks EAI from ever taking off. Because if South Korea ever wants to have the geographic And Pakuna, this is how, I mean, you know, it's a metaphor. Korea is, she calls the Korean Peninsula the land bridge between the east, you know, and even further east, meaning Japan and essentially the Pacific, and west. You can't do that when you've got this entity physically blocking you. And so, interestingly enough, this entire project ended up turning to North Korea, even though I didn't really want it to. And I began to realize that actually North Korea is the pivot to this entire project. Now, I think there's actually a specific reason why China decided purposely to have an entire, just a voided area when it comes to, you know, east of its own vision. I don't have time to explain it, but that's related to China's concerns about extraterritorial stability and so on. But the point is, for South Korea cannot ignore it. So something very interesting happened. I argue that One Belt, One Road, the real sort of revolutionary aspect, the real profoundly important part of One Belt, One Road, will be that it marks a significant shift of China's foreign policy. In fact, East Asia Initiative will also be a similar type of watershed for South Korea's foreign policy, particularly its North Korea policy. And that is actually the true innovation of the East Asia Initiative. What do I mean by this? Well, until the Cold War, the resurrection of the connection of the South Korea's regional and global strategies with an inter-Korean objectives. Okay, what do I mean? Essentially, until the end of the Cold War, South Korea's foreign policy essentially consisted of only one thing, and that was North Korea. Right, everything else, all of its other relationships were all based on its connection to what it would mean for North Korea, what it would mean for inter-Korean relations. With the end of the Cold War, that is actually when these linkages were severed. And in fact, after the success of Notae was Nordpolitik, South Korea began to emerge on the global stage in earnest. And most interestingly, in the post-Cold War era, Kim Il-sung's Saegyeowa was the first time that the ROK began to pursue its expansion of foreign relations with the rest of the world independent of developments in or pursued by North Korea. In other words, it said, actually, we don't really care what North Korea, you do whatever you want to do. You cause all your own problems. We will deal with you separately. It has nothing to do with what we, our objectives are on the global scale and our relationships with every other foreign country. And in fact, remarkably, that was a very consistent theme that stayed throughout South Korea's foreign policy. Even the dramatic shift towards sunshine policy, that was dramatic only in South Korea's relationship with North Korea. Completely turned it around. It actually, but was very consistent and built on, in fact, the policies that came before. So Kim Dae-jung, Nomuyon, they actually said, North Korea will treat you differently, but the rest of the world, we will continue. We're going to go venture forth, and we will do this independently of what North Korea does. This was continued, by the way, by Lee Myung-bak, and rather successfully with his Global Korea Project. So the real shift now comes with Park Geun-hye. And I would argue that when Park Geun-hye announced her East Asia initiative back in 2013, I'm not certain that she necessarily had in mind that this is what she was going to do, mark a profound shift in the connection between inter-Korean developments and South Korea's foreign policies. I think events, in a way, sort of overtook her original goal. I think I'm going to give her the benefit of the doubt and argue that I think she really did have every intention of launching Trustpolitik toward North Korea and East Asia Initiative. Those two actually work very well together because it says we are now going to expand. We're going to have a connection to the rest of Europe. But the key is not just economic. She says the purpose of that economic link is to create a continent of peace. Okay, she made that very clear. So it wasn't just the economic and the social and the geographic and the physical linkages from Asia to the West, or Eurasia, and the Korean Peninsula to the rest of Asia, but actually she said, build a continent of peace. Now, that means, how do you have peace on a continent when you don't have peace on the Korean Peninsula? So in a way, it assumed that somehow some sort of peace settlement or reconciliation in of some manner would unfold with North Korea. Now, clearly, North Korea was going to have none of this. I think Park Geun-hye, you know, laid it all out in Trustpolitik. By the way, Trustpolitik was not all that different from the existing policy. And combined with the Dresden policy, and North Korea heard it, Kim Jong-un stomped all over it and shipped it, put it on the head of a nuclear, a missile, and shot it, you know, right into the EC and said, take that. We want nothing to do with this. And so I think what you see, particularly this year, as events unfolded in January, that it's becoming very clear that you cannot have an East Asia initiative. I mean, it's a nice vision over there, but you've got this major hurdle called North Korea. Trust policy, politics is also essentially dead. Now you have Park Geun-hye's own domestic issues at home, which makes things worse. But essentially, so North Korea is the barrier, and none of this actually can come true until South Korea resolves the North Korea problem. And I think now this is what we have been seeing for the last year. South Korea has begun to launch a very concerted policy to say, look, we can no longer divorce and separate developments on inter-Korea, relations with North Korea, and the rest of the world. And in fact, especially after North Korea's fourth and fifth nuclear test, Park Geun-hye spent the better part of the spring traveling around the world, leveraging all of our relationships with many of these countries, which, by the way, are part of the East Asia Initiative, to say, are you going, in exchange, are you going to support us on North Korea or not? I mean, she went to Africa, she went to Southeast Asia, she went to all these other, you know, traditional supporters of North Korea and said, you have a choice to make, and you're either going to support us or you're going to support them. So for the first time, she was linking back South Korea's foreign policy relationships directly with North Korean interests. And I think that's actually the real revolution. It's not clear how long South Korea can keep this up. You know, South Korean politics is a famous pendulum. And yes, who knows if Park Geun-hye will even be able to last until December 2015. There will be a significant shift, just like we saw in Washington last week. It will happen. But again, remember that wild shifts in policies in South domestic politics in South Korea has not had significant shifts on its foreign policy orientation. So it's not clear what will happen when a new leadership comes in and whether or not South Korea will once again move to a time where it's going to divorce, separate North Korea policies from foreign policies. I will say one other thing, just to tie this all back together with China, that, again, this is not occurring in a vacuum. South Korea is not making these sorts of decisions in a vacuum independently of everything else. It is crucial that China has been assertively and aggressively pursuing One Belt, One Road towards its west, north, and south. That has affected South Korean calculations. Even more interestingly, it's also been... We have to consider what else China has been doing directly in the region, and that's certainly China's muscular activities in the South China Seas and East China Seas. The China's declaration of the Air Defense Identification Zone, the ADIZ, that was in November of 2013. Okay, and the timing is important. Only 1 month after Park Geun-hye initially announced the Eurasia Initiative. I think that was a shocking moment for South Koreans, because until then, most South Koreans had viewed the security threat of China. It's a sort of scholarly mental exercise. It doesn't directly affect us. We understand why the United States hopes. We understand why Japan and all these other countries have territorial disputes. It doesn't really affect us. We've got our own security problems. It's sort of we can be bystanders. Not after announcement of ADIZ, because it included, shockingly to South Koreans, Iedo. Or Parangdo, basically Suyan Rock, which for South Korea had not been an issue with China. And suddenly now China was beginning to claim this as its own, along with the Paracels, all of these other islands. So now I think that was really the wake-up moment for China. That and China's surprise, it's not really surprising to most of us, but I think to South Korea it was, China's willingness to insert itself in the domestic debates over the implementation of THAAD. Okay, and the reason that's important is it essentially is in getting itself involved in domestic debates about South Korea's sovereign choices in the right to defend itself. And again, this marks China's significant shift. Until now, China has been extremely reluctant to get involved directly in these sorts of domestic debates. Not so with THAAD. So whether that's an indication of how crucially important THAAD is to China, my suspicion is that it's not that, but rather that THAAD is only one small issue amongst China's broad concerns, which, as I mentioned, is its concern about extraterritorial stability. And the Korean Peninsula is probably the single most important extraterritorial region for China that has to remain stable. So I think these dynamics all combined together are... Now, we are right in the midst of it, so it's hard to see exactly where it will go. But we're in the midst of a very, very significant shift in foreign policies of both China and South Korea. Those of us in Washington, it's hard for us to really care, given what's happening just down the street. But I promise you that in a few years' perspective time, this could probably prove even more significant than, the surprise of Donald Trump taking the White House. So we'll see. Sorry, I've talked way too long, but I hope there's enough time for some questions. So thank you for your attention. Sorry, it took way too long, I think, but... Sorry, I have a lot of really interesting slides. Oh, this was just, if you missed it. Well, I can't. This was the rail link that would have connected through North Korea, which, by the way, South Korea proposed and North Korea just ignored. And then this is the declaration of the ADIZ. Okay, and this shows exactly where Socotra Rock, the Iedo is. So, okay.
Thank you for the very engaging presentation and for your kind words at the beginning. I think we have about a half hour left, so I'd like to open up the floor to your questions. Please, before you ask your question, wait for the mic and state your name and affiliation before asking your question. Just right here.
Yeah. Is it on? Okay. Bill Jones from Executive Intelligence Review. I'd just like to comment in terms of the origin of the Belt and Road. That project was gestating for about 25 years in China, and the first New Silk Road conference was actually in 1996, and the first road was built, you know, by 2001. So it became a major issue because of many of the reasons that you indicated. I'm much more optimistic. I don't think it's going to go away because it's in China's interest, and it's in the interest of the other countries, and they have the economic might to deal with this, to push this through. The question is, will the rest of the world join and make this into a what I call a world land bridge, including the United States? And this is probably the most important element. If the United States decides that this is a Chinese gambit that should be stopped or undermined, then we're in trouble. But if the United States is willing to cooperate with that, this is a new era for humanity, so that what November 2013, maybe looking back on it, is a shift from a long period of economic decay in Europe and in the United States, and a major shift towards infrastructural investment, which is pushing the world towards a new era for potentially for all of mankind. I'm kind of optimistic, too, although I didn't vote for him. Donald Trump's talking about infrastructure, and that's a very interesting connection here with China. And the Chinese, I think the foreign ministry yesterday said, we'd be happy to work together with the new administration on infrastructure. If that occurs, this is a whole new ballgame. And I think North Korea would be a part of this and should be a part of this. I mean, the way you portrayed that, I was a little concerned because it seemed that they have a plan and China has a plan. I see it differently. South Korea should be a part of that, and it should be directed towards changing the economic situation, hopefully in North Korea, building the railroad that is discussed there, doing things like that that possibly would change the whole political paradigm here. And I'm just asking, my question would be, are there not forces in South Korea now who see this a little more positively and would like to link up and maybe concrete plans to link up to what China is doing on this Belt and Road?
Okay, well, I mean, I don't quite think it's that binary. I actually am mostly in agreement with almost everything you said. Here's the thing. So, yes, that's my point. One Belt, One Road, again, announced November 13th, well, the One Belt part, and then later in March, the One Road. The point is, it's sort of a post facto reality. It's putting a name on something that China's been doing, as you say, even for decades, even maybe 20, 30 years. By the way, whether or not the United States is in support of it or not, I start off by saying, actually, the United States hasn't been paying attention. So that's part of the problem. Those that have, I don't know, actually, the U.S. government, not only, well, the point is not whether it's we endorse it, we think it's a great thing, we're going to support it, we're positive, and it's not we're going to oppose this is dangerous for U.S. interests. It's actually neither of those things. In fact, the current administration, Obama administration, I'm trying to remember the exact date, I believe it was right around 2013 or 2012 or 2013, right around the time of Asia Pivot. Asia Pivot was announced, and the United States, under the direction of the State Department, actually came up with this idea of initiating a new Silk Road. And the reason the United States did this was supposed to shore up Obama's plan to actually withdraw from Afghanistan. As you know, the Asia Pivot was part of that. It was, we're going to draw down in the Middle East and sort of shift some resources towards Asia. But then they were most concerned about the security situation in Afghanistan. And as the United States was trying to draw out, it actually was encouraging China and others to invest dramatically in Afghanistan. And actually, all this infrastructure building through Afghanistan, neighboring Pakistan, so on, was considered very positive by the United States. Better that other countries do it and not us, because we're pulling out. And then sort of said behind the scenes, oh, we're gonna call it the New Silk Road. And actually, I think this is public knowledge. It must be. The Chinese government came and said, oh, no, you can't call it that. And the U.S. government just said, why not? We think it's a great name. It revives all this, you know, ancient history, and this is great, and you guys, Asians, well. And Chinese said, no, that's our plan. That's our idea. You come up with your own name for it. We're going to have our own idea. And lo and behold, called One Belt, One Road. So, no, I think you're right. I mean, as far as the U.S., at least this administration, they're perfectly, I mean, there's nothing to really oppose in terms of China developing this. It's actually strategically, globally for China, for the United States, probably positive. Because it means, first of all, the most important thing is building infrastructure, developing Afghanistan's economy, shoring up all the other Central Asian countries. This is all good. The dilemma is that Chinese investments support autocratic, not very savory regimes. There's always been that tension. But aside from that, no, I think the United States has not actively opposed it, and I don't think the United States views it as a threat. Question is, what will President Trump do? I do not play the game. In fact, I don't even think it matters what Trump has said or will say, because we just don't know. So I don't know about that. I agree with everything you said. I agree with you. I think it's here to stay. It's not going away. So it's not that I'm not positive about it. I just am not sure if it can achieve everything it can, and it will reach some economic barriers. As far as South Korea is concerned, look, I think this has been the problem with North Korea. It doesn't matter what the rest of the world, what China, United States, South Korea wants North Korea to do. North Korea has clearly shown that it is not interested. So we can have all these grand visions, and we all think that this is where North Korea should go. This is what North Korea should do. It's clearly better for North Korea and for everybody else. If North Korea is not interested, then it's not going to happen. So, we can all build plans around ignoring North Korea or if North Korea changes. But until North Korea chooses to, or it's forced to, ultimately, it's just not going to. So that's why I'm not that positive about this. It's just basically on hold. And as for, I didn't mean to portray that South Koreans are not positive about it. I think you're right. I think there's actually a majority of South, I shouldn't use that word. I don't know. But there is essentially a portion of the South Korean society, as well as political leadership, that would like to probably see some more type of engagement or inducements or something with North Korea. But South Korea is a democratic country. We'll see how those elections play out. It's up to the society. So we'll see. We'll see how the shift goes. Is that enough to force Kim Jong-un and his regime to make these choices? I frankly doubt it, but.
I'm sorry, the issue was with China, not so much with North Korea.
Oh.
That is, that they would see themselves as a part of working together with the, with China.
I think that's what China's been trying to do, and guess what? Kim Jong-un stomped all over Park Geun-hye's EAI initiative, and it's done exactly the same thing with China. The one graphic that I didn't have, this is really fascinating. One of the things, that think tank in Germany does is very cool, where it actually shows visually every single foreign city that Xi Jinping has visited during his tenure. And it's remarkable. He's visited more countries than any other Chinese leader all over the world. And you'll see it, even the smallest Pacific islands, there's one glaring, glaring black hole. And it's the closest, geographically closest foreign capital, which is Pyongyang, is the one place that Xi Jinping has not been to. He's been to every other 13 country of bordering China. North Korea is not, and it's not because he hasn't wanted to. For the last 4 years, there have been very, very assertive actions behind the scenes of getting Xi Jinping to North Korea or getting Kim Jong-un to come to China. That has not yet happened. And the reason is not because China doesn't want it to. China would love to go into North Korea and shore up. In fact, it actually still is, despite the sanctions. That's part of the problem. Okay, so no, it's not what China wants or not. It's what North Korea is willing to do. And Kim Jong-un has said, no, thank you. I'm not stepping foot in China, and no top leadership of China is coming to visit. I mean, certainly not Xi Jinping is not welcome. Hasn't happened yet. So I don't know, it could. But I just, it's not an issue of what China wants. I think we have to, you know, we have to realize that North Korea may be the smallest, poorest, least developed, you know, on the verge of collapse country supposedly in the world, but it is perfectly capable of forging its own path, which is exactly what it's been doing, despite everybody's predictions and assumptions.
Yes.
Russell Pittman from the Antitrust Division at the U.S. Department of Justice. The views expressed are not necessarily those of the U.S. Department of Justice. If we return to your first map, which I won't ask you to do, a rail route from eastern China to Hamburg or Madrid or whatever it is. People have been talking about it for a while. Mm-hmm. There are really only three broad paths that can take, and each of them has its problems. It can go through Russia.
That's right.
It can go through Iran. Or it can go across the Caspian Sea and the Black Sea and the Caucasus and through Ukraine. None of those is a real easy route going forward. Russia can block it tomorrow if it wants to, or charge a monopoly rate, because both of those routes you showed in the first map go through Moscow. Do you have any thoughts on which one of those three routes is going to be the one that works, or will they do it all by sea instead because they can't make it work on land?
Oh, no, this whole dream doesn't work by doing only one. This is actually sort of the beauty and the genius behind One Belt, One Road. And China, ever pragmatic, right, and it's got the resources to do this. You're exactly right. And in fact, all three of those routes are being developed by China. What I don't have is the map that shows a rail link to Iran. That's already in progress. And again, it's sort of spine tingling if you actually take a look. I mean, I cannot actually underestimate how important that rail link through Pakistan is. By the way, China has a whole other strategy where it's at the same time developing this with Pakistan, it's doing something else with India. You know, it's setting fire to the hair of Indian and Pakistani leaders. That's partially the point. It's actually to get them. And, by the way, did I forget Bangladesh? I forgot to mention Bangladesh. Building ports in Cambodia, in Myanmar, in Laos. Okay, so again, I don't have the map, but links it. And then also with Russia. And actually, Russia is very much behind this. And that's why I threw out Shanghai Cooperation Agreement, the SCO. This is important because at the most recent agreement, with Russia's backing, Iran is trying to gain membership. Now, this is a whole now the others sort of said no, but Afghanistan and Pakistan and India are now, I think they're elevated to almost full member, beyond observer. That's an interesting development, which Iran was not going to stand by and watch. So it's, talk about the great game, right? It's really amazing what's happening. And I think China's hedging its bet by building all three of those railroads. Right now, Chinese-Russian relations are very good. And I think right now, and they're working cooperatively to expand the northern routes, Trans-Siberian. But you're right. At any moment, Putin or future Russia could decide to turn on China. China knows this probably better than we do. So it's hedging its bet. And depending on the fallout of what happens in Europe and in the Baltics, you're exactly right, which is why China's got the southern route through the Red Sea, through Africa, and linking it through the Mediterranean that way. And it's got its other... you know, options covered again with this maritime route. But one cannot be done without the other. They have to ultimately be connected. And it's really quite the most astonishing project once you delve into it. It's amazing.
Question in the back.
Hello, my name is Christian Jepson. I'm with the National Iranian American Council. My views will not represent.
Oh, so you may know a lot more about this than I do, then.
It's fascinating to me that the large trade agreements like the TPP and CETA could collapse because of internal divisions within the participants. What sort of divisions do you anticipate could potentially cause the One Belt, One Road initiative to potentially weaken or unravel entirely?
Wait, I'm sorry. I didn't quite hear the part. You said TPP, due to internal divisions, where?
the TPP, due to the internal divisions like the U.S. Electing Trump, the TPP is most likely going to unravel. CETA, the free trade agreement between Canada and the EU, very nearly unraveled due to internal divisions in Belgium. Do you think there's any internal divisions within the participants of the One Belt, One Road initiative that could weaken it or perhaps even cause it to ultimately fail?
Oh, so you mean domestic developments, right? Basically, and then sort of all kind of there seems to be a pattern of sort of these populist surges, and you're right. I think the Belgians, and actually it wasn't even just the Belgians; it was the Flemish, particularly, right? It's fascinating that one small group can actually essentially hijack, right? But I think One Belt One Road is fundamentally different because it's China's. It's China's vision, and it's actually going out and spreading it to other countries. So other countries can either participate or not. Most countries along that path are finding that the choice is pretty obvious. I mean, it's not really an issue of, you know, resistance is futile. It's why wouldn't we want to participate? This is going to happen, and it brings with us all sorts of immediate economic benefits and others. I think that there can be some, as you point out, domestic backlash in some of the recipient countries, and you're already seeing that in some of them, you begin to see the backlash, and you see this all throughout Europe as well, but certainly in Southeast Asia and now in Africa and Latin America with the commodities crash, where locals are beginning to resent, you know, all this massive Chinese investment, right? Billions of dollars that brought all this economic wealth and rapid development for a number of years, and then now suddenly, what are we left with? You know, pollution, corruption, all sorts of things. So, and I think you will see some of that, but in general, the governments that are recipients or partners with China, probably for now, are quite receptive to this. But, that's why you see backlash in Europe, too, to a lot of the deals with China. You see this in Germany, in the UK, in France. So it's there, and I think your point is an excellent one. I think that China probably needs to be a lot more mindful about it. I'm certain the leadership is very mindful. I'm quite paranoid, actually. But so you're right. I think that could absolutely be true. But I think it's fundamentally different from multilateral agreements like TPP or others, because that is just, I mean, that's sort of the nature, both the benefit and nature of multilateral agreements. It's multiple participation, essentially on an equal status with a number of countries, where in this case, it's just participatory. So that does make it fundamentally different.
James Sang, retired. You showed the map of the rail lines to North Korea, and certainly its symbolic value is substantial. But in fact, from a logistic point of view, exactly how valuable is that? You point out, for example, that the One Belt, One Road, a lot of it goes south looking for ports. So a lot of it still winds up. So South Korea is still in a very good position port-wise. And
I'm so glad that you mentioned that. That's an excellent point. Yes, and in fact, part of Park Geun-hye's grand vision for what eventually EAI could achieve, people thought, well, isn't it a little bit, who does Korea think it is? It thinks that it can actually make this much of an impact, but actually it does. And the thing is that it is precisely because of how good South Korean ports are that actually these rail links exponentially increase the value. Because right now, Busan is one of the busiest hubs, and despite Hanjin's current difficulties, South Korea's maritime and its port facilities and infrastructure is very, very advanced. If South Korea could actually make geographic land links, because think about it, South Korea is a geographic island. It has no geographic physical links with any other land bordering countries, not a single one. And the reason it can't is because of North Korea is blocking the path. But opening it up, and if you open up the northern border of North Korea, you have two countries, right? Russia and China. But absolutely crucial, because it opens up an entire, it's an entire, horizon of east-west trade. For China, too, it's crucial, because it means direct access to the Pacific Ocean. Right now, China's access to the Pacific, it has to be around the Korean Peninsula, which is why North Korea remains so valuable as an independent country, because North Korea can leverage that. Because, in fact, it is working on building free trade zones with China, which put on hold, and also with Russia. So Najin is the other key port, right? So it's absolutely geographically crucial, and it can open up, and by the way, it also opens up energy supplies for South Korea, which right now are limited just to maritime ports. So one cannot actually underestimate the incredible value of having a geographical link. But again, it's there's only so much. It goes through the Korean Peninsula. But once it's connected all the way to Busan, and, you know, the romantic idea is you get on the Orient Express, you board in Victoria Station in London, sit on the train for God only knows how many days, travel all the way and you end up in Busan, and then you get on a boat and you sail into San Francisco Harbor. Right? No, but I mean, maybe with a stop in Tokyo on the way. No, but I mean, but that's the vision. And I mean, ultimately, if you ever did build that land bridge, there's talk about actually building some sort of Asian version of the Channel or something to one of the Japanese islands. And then you are talking about an actual geographic link.
Oh, don't forget the Aleutians as well.
That's right. Well, yes, that's the other. No, but those pipelines, I don't have that map, those pipelines are already a reality as well. If you look at the activity that's going on that Russia and China are doing in the Far East, it's quite remarkable. But the most amazing thing is giant black hole where North Korea is. And it blocks all this activity. So it's ultimately, you know, 21st century globalization, geography still matters. It's the only thing that matters, apparently. It's the final frontier that has yet to be crossed.
In the very back.
Yes, hi. My name is Adrian Yim. I'm an international development expert. A few years ago, I was in Tajikistan. And then there is obviously a lot of activities going on, building the infrastructures. And it's one of the things that maybe I really appreciate your overview of a macro framework and things like that. But I'm thinking about the micro level. Is success of that One Belt, One Road initiative taken by China probably largely depends on in the participating countries in the long run? Because I observed a lot of resentment by the local people for China's, building road is nice, but then it is often that the case is showcase. Mm-hmm. It's not really putting anything to add to GDP, or it's more like perceived by local people as Chinese, like elevating Chinese labor problem, oversupply of labor. To relocate in, you know, participating countries. And it is creates a lot of resentment by the local people. At the same time, also this you mentioned the energy strategy. Also it is adding a lot of natural resources, which China is hungry. So they are also even building the dams to divert their water from, you know, this poor country to their inland. So it has, I'm not sure how, it will play out in the long run, how it's going to happen. At the same time, I have seen a lot of African countries, I travel quite extensively, they have the same problem. So we'll see how that, you know, play out in the long run. And then second, it is a question. You mentioned about the Korea's initiative to linking to Central Asia. Is there anything to do with ethnic Koreans live there in some of the Central Asian countries? How that, you know, perceived or, you know, related to Korea initiative?
Okay, so I'm really glad you brought up those points. I agree with you 100%. Actually, if you read the paper, I go into discussion of this, so I encourage you to do that. I also encourage you to go back and look up the links to the original papers I wrote several years ago about Central Asia and Southeast Asia. This is actually a crucial point. I didn't have time to mention this. The reason why, again, it's sort of, if you think about it, on the surface, a little laughable that you would even compare China's One Belt, One Road with tiny South Korea's East Asia initiative, right? I mean, you cannot compare the two in terms of absolute numbers. It's minuscule. But frankly, any other country does is minuscule compared to what China does. So that's partially natural. But in fact, what's fascinating is South Korea's East Asian initiative actually thinks it can maybe not directly compete, but at least even play on the same field as China. And why? precisely because, as you say, East Asia, South Korea itself, but also East Asia Initiative, plays on some very interesting weaknesses about One Belt, One Road. One of those is, and this gentleman back there was trying to point out about the domestic surges of resentment or divisions that can occur. This is very closely tied. And I think, again, you are seeing this. There is significant backlash in countries all over the world that have been the targets or beneficiary of Chinese investment. For goodness sake, I mean, this was partially, I think, what led to Trump's, the populist surge, right? I mean, he ran on anti-China rhetoric. So it plays very, very well among, citizens who have been affected at one point were sort of dangled with economic opportunity but then taken away, okay? And part of it on the heels of Chinese investment, partially the commodities crash. But so Central Asian countries feel this. So they feel this economically. There is definitely a sense all over Southeast Asia, Africa, Central Asia, everywhere, and even now in Europe, the fear that they will become economic colonies of China. Right, and if you're Western Europe, you just think of having dependence on China. If you are anywhere in the original Sino tributary state system, then it harkens back to the original where there was Imperial China, and you were basically a tribute state. So I think that fear is there. Number one. Number two, this is why South Korea plays a very, very unique role. And in this sense, actually, it's quite intriguing, the opportunities. South Korea is actually the only country that can really be sort of the honest broker. It offers something to these countries that no other country can. Not the United States, not even Japan, with its billions of dollars of investments, right, through its ODA. Why? Because South Korea is the only one that doesn't have the baggage of great powers. Now, Central Asia especially, but also Southeast Asia, their history is important. They've all been victims of great power battles, great power competition, predations of imperial powers, right, that have come in and exploited their countries, taken them over. So they're all very, very vulnerable to this, and Central Asia particularly. So South Korea is the only one that can say, oh, we're just like you. Nobody knows about victimization and great power predations better than us. Okay, no one knows that you have been valued by your great power neighbors, not for any intrinsic value that you may have or offer, but purely for strategic value. We know this better than anybody else, right? But now we're in a position to help you. Not only that, we've got a fantastic model. United States comes and they point fingers and they lecture you and say, we will withhold development until you improve your human rights. Or China will come in and say, oh, abuse, pretty much anybody you want to, as long as, right? Not everybody's happy with that model, okay? And not everybody's happy with Japan coming in either. South Korea's the only one that can come in and say, we were just like you. In fact, we were probably worse off than you. Right, we were the recipient of ODA. We were the only member of DAC that was a recipient of foreign aid, and now we are a foreign aid donor. That actually carries a lot of resonance for these countries. Maybe for Americans, it's not understood. For these countries, it's actually profoundly important. And South Korea's involvement and relationship does not carry the same kind of baggage and strings that U.S. or China or Russia or any of these other countries does. Number one. Number two, the ethnic connection is extremely important. There is a very special connection that South Korea has with, specifically with Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan. That is an ethnic tie. So again, I encourage you to read the paper, which goes into those connections. Oh, yeah, well, I mean, the cultural, there's no doubt about that.
When I went there, they're like, I feel like I'm Korean.
Except that's it, but it's the same in Africa and South America and everywhere else too. So,
well, these questions were all really great, and as you mentioned several times through answering them, a lot of the answers are a lot of answers are in the paper.
The KEI
so I would highly
papers.
Encourage you to read it. Please pick it up on your way out if you haven't picked it up already, or check it out online. And join me in thanking Dr. Hwang for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Kyle. Thank you.